Another rule that we need to take care of while writing an email is that we need to write for action. The first three lines of our email should clearly specify what the email is about. And we should also ensure that we write what kind of action do we want the reader to take upon reading our email. If that is not specified, the reader may feel that it is just for his information and may not actually do anything on that email. We also need to ensure that when we are writing our email, we give a timeline. Just as we would give a timeline to our to somebody when we are performing a work, we need to give a timeline through email also, that by what date do we want the work to be completed. That ensures that the work is done on the time and the reader is not in any doubt about the work. After we have done all that, let us just once take a look that the work that we want the other person to do, have we detailed out all the information regarding that work in our email or not? If we have not done that, then the reader may be confused, the reader may be lost, the reader may spend considerable amount of time looking for those particular information. So it is always a good idea that we write for action in our email, we specify everything as clearly as possible in our email. Few other rules that we need to take care of when we are writing an email is, first, we need to answer all questions and answer them swiftly. Let us see what I mean by this particular point. If we do not answer all the questions in the original email, we will receive further emails regarding the unanswered questions. And this will not only waste our time and our receiver's time or the reader's time, but will also cause considerable frustration. We need to return the emails within the same time frame that we would return a phone call that we have missed. That is, within the same working day. If we are not able to do that, if we are getting late than the working day, same working day, then there is this option of autoresponder. We could use this autoresponder to let the other person know that we have not read the incoming messages and that when we do, we would respond to them. We also need to anticipate or preempt the kind of questions the other person might ask upon our email and answer those questions in the original email only. This not only shows our thoughtfulness but also indicates that we are highly efficient and meticulous. If we are efficient and meticulous and give away everything clearly, the other person would also try and do the work up to the same standards. A lot of people do not bother to read an email before they send out. And that is the reason that we see emails that have a lot of spelling and grammatical errors. Most people would say it is an email, what is the need for spellings or grammatical errors? But try reading a paragraph which has a lot of grammatical spelling punctuation errors. It won't make sense. In fact, the meaning might get changed also. So, to avoid misunderstandings and inappropriate comments, it is important that before we send out our email, we just have a look at it for all these kind of errors. Not only it is important because these things give bad impression of our company, they do not convey a professional image of us and our company, but they may also distort the meaning of the message completely. Emails with no full stops or commas are difficult to read and they at times change the messages, meaning of the text as I just told you about. And after all, our laptops do give us spell check option. Why not use that and make our emails much more easy to read than a poorly worded one. If we write in emails, it accounts to or it amounts to as if we are shouting. If we write everything in lowercase, we might be perceived as lazy because it is very easy and quick to write without pressing shift keys or caps key. This can be highly annoying and might trigger an unwanted response in the form of a flame email. Therefore, we need to try and not send any email in either capital letters or lowercase. It may be difficult to read. Uppercase and lowercase letters are reading aids that signal a reader about sentence beginning, pronouns and of course acronyms as well, and they should be used for that purpose only. Since reading from screen is very difficult or more difficult than reading from paper, the structure and layout is very important in email messages. We try and we should use short paragraphs and have a lot of blank lines between each paragraph. When making points, we need to number them or mark them so that each point comes across as a separate point. We have all heard about the story of the boy who called wolf. He cried wolf every time, the wolf wasn't there, and ultimately when it happened, nobody was there to help him out. Well, if we use the high priority option frequently or overuse it, then it will lose its function when we really need it. So let us use the high priority option only when it is absolutely necessary to use it. When we reply to an email, we must include the original message in our email. In other words, we need to click on reply instead of new email, composing a new email. Now there are two schools of thought on this particular thing. One school says that you must remove the previous message since it has already been sent, has been read and is therefore unnecessary. It just clutters the space. There is another school of thought which says that no, we should not leave the message, thread message out. If we receive many emails, we obviously cannot remember each and every individual email. We have to then, we have what is called a threadless email. And then, this threadless email will not provide enough information and we will have to spend a frustratingly long time to find out the context of the message or the particular email in order to deal with it. Leaving the thread might take a fraction longer in download time, but it will save the recipient much more time and frustration in looking for the related emails in their inbox. So they say that keeping the message thread helps to increase comprehension of the latest message and show the history of the messages that led up to this point in the exchange. Both the schools are valid in their thought process. I leave it on you to decide what you wish to do it. Ideally, it is said that you should have your message thread there. It not only helps you in understanding the context, but you can always go back to them to understand what led to the particular stage. Then comes the next header in the email thing, which is subject line. It is suggested that we should use a meaningful subject line, because hi and hello in professional context mean nothing. Most of us have read emails that had subject line saying hi, and it had detailed information about the work that we were supposed to do. That hi can be very misleading. It is inappropriate. So we need to try and use a subject that is meaningful to not just the recipient but to ourselves as well. For example, when we send information, we send an email to a company requesting information about a particular product, it is better to mention the actual name of the product than just say information, product, hi, or the name of the company. Better to write I need subject line, product A information. Always fill in the subject field with a brief and concise description of the content of the mail. It is very important in helping those who communicate with it helps them in organizing their content and manage their emails. Create informative subject lines that get quick responses and help readers prioritize their emails. We need to update the subject lines on replies in ongoing stages. But if we begin a new email on an absolutely new subject, the thread is also to be discarded and the subject line also changes based on the content of the new email. This one rule is very, very important in the professional world. Most of us see that at the fag end of the day, our colleague, supervisor or our boss would send out an email and ask us to do the work before the end of the working day. Now, if the end of the working day is 5:30 and we get the email by 5, we are pressing the reader to the wall. We are taking them by surprise. They may not be prepared for it. So let us not do that kind of thing. We should take care that whatever work we need from the other person, we give them considerable time to do the research, to gather the material or do the work, and then come back to us on it. We should not wait until the end of the day to introduce a problem or a particular concern. And if we do, if it is that time of the day only when that arises, then we'll have to do it at that moment. There is no way out. But then we can give the other person some more time. Instead of asking for a quick response, we can ask them to send us the response by the next day. Emoticons are much, much more prevalent these days. Because of the SMS language, emoticons are a rage everywhere. People have started using emoticons in their emails also. But emoticons should be restricted as far as professional world is concerned. Business communication, emoticons should not be there. It could be avoided. It appears to be very funny to us to send an email where at the end of the email we have a rat laughing, holding its belly. But the other person may find it very immature and childish. So we need to limit not just these images but the emoticons as well. And most importantly, we need to make it personal. If we know the receiver, we know the name of the receiver we are on a day-to-day basis, it is better to write their name. Just remember the salutation thing. Dear Mr. Sharma is still better than just dear sir, if you are interacting with Mr. Sharma every day. Or if you call him dear sir only, it's fine, continue with dear sir. But your email should be personalized. The reader should not feel that why has this email been sent to me? How am I related to it? What is in it for me? That should not be the case. We all know what it is like to be flooded with emails, so much so that it is difficult to figure out which one has a priority and which one can be left for later use. If there is a brief summary at the top of the email, the readers can make a decision about whether to save the email for later read or to finish it at that particular time. Business experts often refer to this kind of summary as elevator summary or executive summary. An elevator summary is a summary that can be given to a colleague or employer in the short time that it takes to get from the ground floor to the third floor in an elevator. It has bare essentials of the message, yet it contains all the main components of the email. It is important to provide table of contents on the very first screen of our email. For example, this email contains a budget projections of the last quarter, actual performance of the last quarter, adjustment proposal, and projected profitability. Now, when the reader reads this, he or she knows that, okay, this email contains all these things. This table of content is a very user-friendly gesture towards the reader when they are required to read long messages. It allows them to skip to the sections of the email that apply to them directly and avoid those areas that do not. If the reader needs to respond immediately to an email, that also should be communicated or conveyed in the very first paragraph. Otherwise, the message may be overlooked and the writer may not receive the response as quickly as he or she needed it. Then another thing that we can take care of is that we create headings. For all points that are there, we can create headings. When writing a complaint via email, the writer should provide a very clear picture for the recipient. Mainly because there is a tremendous amount of room for misunderstanding or misinterpretation. It is important that the writer provide a context and state clearly what the problem is and how he or she would like to see the problem resolved. Remind the participant that if the problem is urgent, they should indicate that urgency in their elevator summary and let the recipient know that they need a response as soon as possible. Now, while writing a complaint, it is also important to briefly state the history of the problem, so that we provide a background or the context of the problem for our reader. We also need to explain the attempts that have previously been made to resolve this issue. These first two steps, they are very important whilst writing a complaint. It is important for the writer to provide a context and show the audience that he or she has taken all the necessary and required steps to resolve it. When a person takes the time to show that he or she is contributing to the solution, the message takes on a positive tone that is generally received with greater ease and optimism by the audience. Now, everyone may not agree on what is considered to be a problem. Everybody sees the world in a different manner. That may happen. But when writer clearly states what they perceive to be troublesome, it reduces the possibility of disagreement between them and their audience or their receiver, reader. Labeling something as a problem is not sufficient enough to motivate others to act. The problem must clearly be defined in a way that can foster solutions. Most often, when people receive complaints, the natural reaction is to ask, "So how does this involve me? Why have you sent it to me?" It is vital that writers provide or prescribe course of action to motivate their audience. First, the writer should concede that they may have overlooked an option. Perhaps there are other ways to resolve the problem without calling meetings and sending out intimidating memos. Second, writers should show how they are willing to participate in the solution by suggesting their willingness to meet up with the third party, the party in question, or others. This shows that the writer has goodwill towards the organization. These points, if taken care of, then the complaint is taken in a better manner and everybody is geared up towards finding a solution for the complaint. Well, how do we enforce email etiquette? Nothing can change if we do not change ourselves. It is important that we as individuals remember to follow the etiquette of writing an email rather than waiting for someone to force us to do so. So, in short, email etiquette is self-imposed. If we follow it, we reap rewards from it. This email policy, another thing could be that we create an email policy, written email policy for the company. But this email policy should include all the do's and don'ts concerning the use of company's email system and should be distributed amongst all employees. Employees must be trained to fully understand the importance of email etiquette. We can always do away by saying that etiquette is not important, or that etiquette means you are weird, or that if you are being too polite, you have got of etiquette, you don't have the guts in you. But that is just shirking away from etiquette. The world is a civil place to be, and it pays to be civil. Thank you.